I want to turn our Bibles today to Joshua chapter 15. And I want to talk to you today about the inheritance that God has for all of us. Unto Caleb, the son of Zephaniah, he gave a part among the children of Judah, according to the commandments of the Lord to Joshua, even the city of Arba, the father of Anak, which city is Hebron. And Caleb drove thence the three sons of Anak, Shishai, and Amon, and Talmai, the children of Anak. These were giants. And he went up thence to the inhabitants of Debir. And the name of Debir before was Kirjath-Sefer. And Caleb said, he that smited Kirjath-Sefer and taketh it, to him will I give Achsa, my daughter, to wife. And Othniel, the son of Kenaz, the brother of Caleb, took it. And he gave him Achsa, his daughter, to wife. And it came to pass that as she came unto him, that she moved him to ask of her father a field, and she lighted off her ass. Caleb said unto her, what wouldest thou? Who answered, give me a blessing, for thou hast given me a south land. Give me also springs of water. And he gave her the upper springs and the nether springs. The upper springs and the lower springs. So this morning, I want to talk to your heart. The blessing in your inheritance. Heavenly Father, I pray you hide us behind the cross. Grateful for your many blessings. Thank you, God, for who you are. Thank you for your presence, not only in this house, but even those joining us on the e-campus. And we worship and glorify your name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. It was in December 2009. The news article read, talk about a reversal of fortunes. Two brothers who were so poor, they lived in a cave on the outskirts of Budapest in Hungary and got by selling scavenged junk, found themselves in line to receive a $6.6 billion inheritance from a long-lost grandmother, the UK Daily Telegraph reported. Zoli and Giza Pelody had been informed that they were entitled to the fortune, along with her sister who lived in the United States. Charity workers in Hungary passed on the good news to the brothers after being contacted by lawyers handling the estate of their maternal grandmother, who died in Baden-Württemberg, Germany. The brothers reported that they knew their mother came from a wealthy family, but she was a difficult person and severe ties with them, and later abandoned her boys, and they lost touch with her and their father until she eventually died. Giza Pelody, who was 43 at the time, was quoted as saying on a TV interview, if this all works out, it will certainly make up for the life that we have had until now. All we really had was each other, and no woman would look at us living in a cave. But with money, maybe we can find a partner, build a family, and we'll have a normal life. Under German law, of course, direct descendants are entitled to the share of estates. So as the grandmother's daughter is dead, the money should now go to the grandchildren. The idea is that these two brothers were so poor, they could not even afford a dilapidated apartment. The only place that they could find to live was a cave. And the only way that they could even sustain their living was to find junk and sell it, and had no idea they were entitled to an estate in billions of dollars. A Michigan factory worker earning less than $10,000 a year was an unknown heir to a $500,000 estate. When located by the investigator some years after his benefactor's death, the worker explained that he had lost touch with his family. And here he was barely surviving while he was entitled to an estate, almost $1 million. Notice what happens, friends. It is reported that billions of dollars in inheritance lies unclaimed in this country. That means folks are struggling and have no idea what they're entitled to. And the more I thought about this, and I thought, oh my God, how many of us, even in a spiritual sense, we are living below the level of our entitlement. The idea is that God has left for us an inheritance. We are entitled to an inheritance as children of God. And so often we settle for less than what God has in store. When you read the book of Joshua is about inheritance. Remember, in Numbers, the children of Israel could have marched from Egypt through the wilderness into the promised land, but because they lacked faith, they could have walked into their inheritance. And notice what happens. They said to Moses, send 12 spies to go into the land, check out the land, and come back and report. The Bible says, 10 spies says, we can't take the land. The land is fruitful, but there are some giants in the land. And they went further. They said, in our eyes, we were like grasshoppers. But thank God for Joshua and Caleb. I'm always amazed that there's no reference after this of those 10 spies. But Joshua and Caleb, my God, when Moses came to the end of his journey, it was Joshua who God allowed to be the successor of Moses. And so Caleb is walking, he's with the group. But notice what happens. Even though they have wandered in the wilderness, when God finally brought them into the land, and that's the record of Joshua, notice Caleb said to Joshua, Joshua, give me this mountain space. He says, I remembered it because I saw it over 40 years ago. And there are so many things that we can learn from Caleb. There's so many traits that we really should learn from this mighty man of God. Because you see, my friends, Caleb had confidence in God. I want you to know, my friends, that in spite of COVID-19, and in spite of what you may be going through, don't lose your confidence in Almighty God. Notice what happens. 40 years wandering, and Caleb never lost his confidence. Being confident of this, that he who has begun a good work in you will complete it. My God, I want every believer to realize that God has made a promise over your life. He has established a destiny over your life. And as long as you don't lose your confidence, you will inherit on this line. You will inherit on this side of Jordan everything that God has promised over your life. In spite of opposition, he didn't lose his confidence. You gotta stop allowing people to talk you out of your confidence in God. They may tell you you are crazy. They may tell you you have lost your mind. But tell them, I'd rather lose my mind and back my confidence in God than to put my confidence in man. He was confident in spite of opposition. But he was confident in spite of obstacles. Notice what happens. He saw the land. He saw the fruitfulness of the land. He also saw the giants in the land, but not even the giants could cause Caleb to lose his confidence. Notice what happens. He was confident because when God has given you a word, all you have to do is to wait for the opportunity. Here's what happened, folks. You and I cannot afford to be at the same place you were pre-COVID-19. Pre-COVID-19, you may have been a casual Christian. Pre-COVID-19, you may have been an up and down Christian. But after God has brought you through, after all you have looked around and see happen, and this morning you're still in the land of the living, you can't lose your confidence in God. If you can handle honesty, I've come to a place, I said, God, after all you have brought me through, I can't hang around grasshoppers anymore. I'll pray for you. I will fast for you. But I can't hang with you because God has greater things in store, and you can't afford to settle for little. Church of God of East Flatbush, let me tell you something. God has brought us a mighty way. We have seen some great things and we have celebrated some great accomplishment, but nothing in the past compares to where God is taking us. I'm not talking about a building. I'm talking about a spiritual breakthrough, not only in your life, but also in this community. He never lost. In 40 years, he never lost his confidence. But there's another thing I love about Caleb. 40 years later, he is just as consistent. You see what a crisis does? A crisis reveals where you are. Oh, I used to do this, but pastor disappointed me and didn't do what I expected. Or the church didn't do what I expected. Or folks didn't do what I expected. And you allow one situation to cause you to step out alignment with God's plan. And many of us have allowed minor issues to cause us to get upset and step off the track. And what you don't realize, it wasn't about the distraction. The devil's plan was to get you off track. The devil will use any. Here's what happened, folks, and which is why, and I salute the fact that you can, I mean, it's, there are times when we may be on each church campus, or there are times when we may be in the building, but there's no time we shouldn't be in community. Thank you, Sister Lisa, for at least giving a shout out too. Because here's what happens. The devil's trick is to get you disaligned with where the blessing flows. And I want you to understand, when God places you at the position where he wants to bless you, the devil knows he can't stop the blessing. But if he can reposition you, if he can get you out of alignment, he doesn't have to worry about the blessing. You yourself disqualify yourself. And I want you to understand, 40 years later, Caleb is not only confident, he says, Joshua, wherever you need me, I'm going to be consistent. Why? Consistency is essential to your destiny. God, if God can't trust you where you are, why should he trust you with a promotion? So some of us go, oh, I've been working at this place for how long? And this person came on after me, and an opening came up. And Bishop, those folks, they didn't give me the job. They gave somebody else. The question I want to ask you, how consistent were you? Because some of us love the Lord until we get upset. Some of us love the Lord until things just don't work the way we expect. I want you to understand that Caleb remained consistent. He never lost faith. Now, I must confess, let's just put it right out there, that if I was chosen as one of the 12, and after I went in and saw the land, and then come back and report, folks, God can give us the land. And 10 says, no, he can't. And the folks lined up behind the 10. I would be a little annoyed, say, all right, okay. You want to walk? Go ahead. But you know what Caleb did? I can't imagine what went through that man's heart. That he marched with the same doubters, watched them die and buried, but he remained consistent. Why? Because he knew God for himself. And here's what happened, Church of God. God is looking for people who are consistent in their faith. You don't give the tithe of offering because you love the pastor. You don't give and support the church because we celebrate you in spite of, even when you're old, you feel overlooked, or when you feel that somebody else may get the credit for what you do. Because you are doing it as unto God. It doesn't matter who gets the credit. You're going to be consistent in the work of the Lord. And so Caleb was consistent in his faith. He was consistent in following. And for the entire season, Caleb says, I'm right here. You can depend upon me, Joshua. But he was also walking in certainty. Some of us are still not sure if God is in control. So when things are going well, you go, oh, what a mighty God we serve. But when things are falling apart, you start panicking. I'm here to say to somebody, you got to stop panicking. In the midst of your test, you got to stand flat-footed and say, God is in control. Oh, the overseer reminded us just 2 weeks ago. Remember Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, when the king says, now you're going to bow, guys. And if you don't bow, we're going to burn you. And they turned the fire up 7 times. And these young boys says, no, king, we're not going to bow. And we know that God is able to deliver. But even if he doesn't deliver, we are going to still stand certain in who we... Here's what happened, folks. We have got to stop giving God an ultimatum. Some of us love God, but when things are going through the testy season, we give God, we said, if you don't do it by Sunday... If you don't let somebody come and visit me, if you don't let somebody come, we put God on an ultimatum. What you're really saying is, God, you're not the boss, I'm the boss. I'm here to say to somebody, resign the position as the boss. Turn it over to God and say, God, I will follow you wherever you lead me. If the good times and the bad times, I'm going to be certain. Notice what happens. See, Caleb was certain of the presence of God. He was certain of the promises of God. He was certain that God had promised them a land. But notice what happens. Caleb was also courageous. These are traits we need to demonstrate, not tomorrow, but today. God is looking for courageous people. And here's the amazing thing. Many of us have disqualified ourselves from God's destiny over our lives because we lost courage in crucial moments. So there was a giant by the name of Goliath, over 9 feet tall, and the entire Saul and his army were so intimidated that nobody would approach Goliath. But a young boy by the name of David shows up sees this giant on the other side of the hill crying out, send me a man. And if they will defeat me, we will serve you. And if I defeat them, you will serve us. And David, a young boy, looks and watches all the grown people tremble. Can I tell you something? God is not restricted by age. And God is not limited by age. Here's what happened. The grown, experienced soldiers are nervous, but a little boy, David, shows up and says, I take him on. And here's what happened. Can you imagine all these soldiers who are battle tested, who have been trained as professional soldiers, and young David comes, I will fight. And they tried to talk David out to fight him. But here's the amazing thing. When they couldn't talk him out, Saul says, oh, at least put on my armor. When they put it on young David, he says, no. When I had to battle the bear and the lion, I didn't have an armor on. All I had was a spiritual armor. And if that spiritual armor could work back then, that spiritual armor can work. And notice what happens. David took his sling and his stones and went out and faced Goliath. My God, and notice what happens when that boy swung that sling. The Bible says when he discharged that stone, it hit the giant right in the forehead. He fell on the ground. David ran up to him, took out his sword, cut off his neck. My God, I'm here to say to somebody, stop running from your giant. Stop quivering from your giant. Trust the mighty God. You have what it takes. You got the anointing of God over your life. Stop letting little giants intimidate the God that is in you. Here's what happens. Caleb demonstrated courage. And one of the things I love about the Lord, we always see not only the test, but we see the blessing. God bless Caleb. As a result, if there's anything, you need to make a quick note, because these are the traits I'm trying to practice in this season of my life. We come to the point, I'm going to run just sort of, because here's what happens. And the Bible tells us that when Joshua began to make distribution of the land, the first tribe to be lined up was not the firstborn. The first tribe that was called forward for the allotment, you see, what God did was, he promised them the land, but in order to determine where in the land they would settle, they had what they call the Urim and the Thummim. These are stones in the armor of the priest's vest. And so for them to decide where the tribe was going to settle, they would use the Urim and Thummim, these two stones, shake them like a lot. Cast lots, and God would show his will through these stones. Now, I don't want anyone getting the impression that the lottery is endorsed. No. What I'm saying is that God would show his will through these stones. And so notice what happens when they now decided which tribe would go first. It fell upon Judah. Well, Judah was not the first. You see, here's what happens. The interesting thing was that God wanted to show his sovereign choice. And so the spiritual significance, it led Eliezer cast the sacred lots and determined that the tribe of Judah would be the first tribe to receive their allotment. Now, we don't have the time, because you see what happens is that the firstborn should have been what? Reuben. Reuben was supposed to be the firstborn. But in Genesis 49, we can't take the time to read it, make a note. Before Jacob died, remember Jacob, the trickster, Jacob who robbed Esau, Jacob who was crooked, but God turned his heart and called him blessed Israel. He became the father on his deathbed. He called his boys and he says, I want to tell you what my will is. He says, Reuben, you are the firstborn, but you got some issues. You see, Reuben, I know you didn't know, but you were messing with your papa's girlfriend. So when Reuben went up and slept with his father's concubine, he was dishonoring his father. Now, he could have found other women, but he had to make a point by saying, I am conquering my father by sleeping with his concubine. And so Jacob says, you got some issues. Then he turns around to the next two, and that was Simeon and Levi. And he says, you know, when your sister Dinah was raped, you guys did something which was not honorable. You caused bloodshed. Your hands are bloody. And then he goes, and you see we're in 49:1-6, where he called the boys and he talks to Reuben and talks to Simeon and Levi. And he says, Levi, you won't get any property. Your allotment, your property would be to be the custodians of the work of God. So the Levites didn't get land. They got a spiritual land to remind them and to remind us. It's not just land that's here, but it's also an assignment which is beyond here. So the Levites, notice what happens. The Levites had eras that they could live in, residence, but they didn't have the title as the other tribes did. But notice what he says when he called Judah. He says, but Judah, thou art he whom thy brethren praise. That, now notice, thy hand shall be in the neck of thine enemies. Thy father's children shall bow down before thee. Judah is a lion's whelp. From the prey, my son, thou art gone up. He stooped down. He coaches a lion, and as an old lion, who shall rouse him up? The scepter shall not depart from Judah, nor a lawgiver from between his feet until Shiloh come, and unto him shall the gathering of the people be. Notice what he's doing. He's pronouncing an anointing upon Judah. So when you go even to Revelation, notice that Jesus is described as the lion of the tribe of Judah. Can I say to somebody today, there is an inheritance over your life that has nothing to do with your birth order. It doesn't matter who came before you. It doesn't matter who came after you. God has a sovereign plan. Oh my God, if we could ever come to the realization, when you surrender to God, when you do God's will, it doesn't matter who is above you. God will allow them to disqualify themselves. So you are up. So here's what happens. So we see where there's a spiritual inheritance. But then in chapter 15, we also see where the land is distributed. He says unto Caleb, who was the general for Judea, he marked out the space in the southern part of the land. And he says, Caleb, this is the region given to Judea. But notice what happens. Not only do we see a spiritual assignment, we also see land. I want you to understand, God is interested in land. Stop telling me about heaven. You can have a little piece of land right here. We got to understand, he wants to bless you in the future, but he wants to bless you right now. So notice then, you have a personal pursuit. It's one thing for the church to have a pursuit, but the question I want to ask you, what are you pursuing personally? So notice what happens in the region he gave Caleb. That was where the giants resided. See, Joshua discerned that Caleb had the face to take on the giants. Can I say to somebody today, God is not going to give you what you're not willing to take on. So then he says to, so in Joshua 15 and 14, here's the amazing thing. Caleb brought his tribe together and his little army together. And he says to them, he says, we're going to take on these giants. We're going to take this town, Kirjath Sefer. And he says, I want to see the young man who is willing to stand up and lead this charge. If you will, I give you my daughter, Ashka, for wife. Now, most likely, obviously, Othniel would not have volunteered if she was an ugly. Okay, I shouldn't say that. Now, the idea was, most likely, Caleb already knew that Othniel was interested. Probably he already saw them hanging out. But Caleb wanted to give a test. Because when you are an old warrior, you don't need any wimp to come in your house and marry your daughter and inherit your legacy. You need a warrior just like yourself. You don't want to work all these years and accumulate wealth for the next generation. And then one day, your daughter brings some guy who can't keep a job at McDonald's. I don't care where you work, at least you should be able to keep a job. You should be able to show courage. And it's not where you work, it's where your heart is, it's where your head is, it's where your commitment. And so Caleb says, because when you're 85, you can't function like you are 45. No, I know there's a lot of us. When we would do the men's retreat, I can tell you on the first day of the retreat, if we don't have to take one person to the clinic, we have to bring them to the nurse's station, because I don't know what happened to men. They are 40. Here's what happened. We just get away for a little retreat. They have never walked a mile while they're in New York City. They have never gone to the gym and work out half an hour. But we go on a men's retreat, and they are going to be Michael Jordan or Magic Johnson. Not even 20 minutes later, the body begins to talk to them. The knee begins to talk to them. The heart begins to talk to them. Do I have a witness in the house? Now you can be 85 and you are still muscular, but you can't be 85 in age and trying to play a 45. At some point, you gotta wake up and realize your gift to the community is not your muscle, it is your mind. My God, you don't have to compete with the young men. You got to coach the young men, mentor the young men. You got to teach the young men. And so at 85, Caleb didn't have to lead the army. He needed somebody who showed his courage. Young boy by the name of Othniel, who happened to be his own nephew, the son of his brother, comes up and say, Uncle, I may not be quick to fight, but I love the reward. And if you're going to give Aksa to the man who defeats these giants, I'm your man. And the Bible says that Othniel, by the way, which means the lion of God, defeated the giants. Now, this is the part that got me up in the middle of the night. Because 40 years before, when they could have walked into the promised land, they says, no, they're giants in the land. We're like grasshoppers. And they came back to the folks and walked almost 40 years later. Notice in chapter 15, in one verse, The Bible says, and Caleb defeated the giants in one verse. My God, can I say to somebody, what have intimidated you in 40? For 40 years, God can give you victory over in one verse. And the Bible says, they defeated the giants. I want you to understand that giant is anything that stands up to intimidate you. A giant is anything that tries to roll over you. You got to understand, folks, with God, you are mightier than the giant. With grace and faith, you can defeat every giant, whatever that situation is. And the Bible says, and they took the land, and here's the part I want to run to. So we see God's sovereign choice by allowing Reuben and the other older tribes to disqualify themselves. Amen. We also see the conviction or the courage of Caleb at 85 years old. But this is the part I want to close on, is the convincing claim of Aksa. There's something about this young woman that I admire. Notice what happens is that in marrying the daughter of the general, you inherit certain land. So the land that Caleb gave his daughter was large, but had no water. It was large, but lacked water. It was large and lacked water. And so she says to Othniel, whatever she called him, O.T., go to Pops and tell him we need water. Time and time and time again, she says, Othniel, go to Pops and tell him we need water on the property. Because what is property without water? But he didn't respond. So one day, she got in her donkey and she rode up to Papa. And the Bible says, and she alighted. I love the poetry of scripture. In other words, she just stepped down gracefully. And when she stepped off that donkey, Caleb said, honey, what is your desire? Now, if you are a father and you don't have a daughter, buy one, borrow one, beg one, get one. Because if you are a father and you have raised boys, you know that you raise the girls totally different. So raising RC and Andre, all we're doing is, come on, son, you gotta be strong, firm, consistent, know, have a welfare mind. Probably push them a little too hard. So now when they remind me, I just sit there and take it. God, yes. Yes. But then when Sigourney comes along, I remember we took the family on a trip to Miami. And so we went, okay, let's drive. Drove all the way from Canada. And then we just enjoy time and we are do the Disney and we hit the beach. And Sigourney's like 2 years old. And we're out there in the water, and the wave is just coming and just beating us over. Two-year-old Sigourney gets up, whoops, wave just took her down. She gets up, the wave just knocked her over. She just looks at me and goes, Dad, do something about it. Now, if you're a father, a girl father, they have a shortcut to your heart. And sometimes even your wives use the shortcut. Can you go and tell your dad, ask your dad, does he want to? Ask your dad, would he like to drive us go to shop at the mall? Because he drove us last week and I know he's gonna say no. And then Sigourney walks into my office and goes, Dad, would you like to take me to the mall? Okay, Sigourney, which mall? Woodbury. Oh, that's a little way, but okay. So, okay. But the point I want to make is that a girl has a shortcut to her father's heart. And here's the amazing thing. I'm going from the natural and then I'm going to do the spiritual. When she alighted off the donkey, she already knew that her wish was going to be fulfilled. And when Caleb says, "Honey, what do you like?" She says, "You know, Dad, you are the best father. I mean, I would never have another father who is as courageous as you. And you have given me much land. But Pops, I have one request. I need springs. I need water and that land." And there's something that hits me hard. Because this girl demonstrated the very trait that made her father so great. Caleb became great because he refused to settle. Yeah. Caleb became great because he took the initiative. And I'm here to say to God's children that when you may not alight from a donkey, but when you get on your knees and cry, "Abba, Father, my God," there is a shortcut to the heart of Almighty God. God doesn't want to spite you. God doesn't want to see you suffer unnecessarily. The heart of God is for his children. My God, it took me probably too long to learn the love of God. That the love of God was not dependent on my performance. That the love of God was not dependent on how good I was. That the love of God is who he is. In other words, God loves you. And when you understand that God loves you, you don't have to perform. You don't have to go through all kinds of loops. You just alight on your knees and cry, "How great thou art." Can I say to somebody today, a worshiper has a shortcut to the heart of God. In other words, many times what delays our blessing is that we want a blessing without gratitude. We want a blessing in our condition. But when you are a worshiper, I want you to understand that oftentimes I have reflected on that relationship or influence that Sigourney sometimes pulls on. And I said, if my heart as a father with issues can be tugged because of the love of her daughter, much more our heavenly Father, when a worshiper cries, when a worshiper reaches out, forget what's not working, forget what you desire, forget what you hope for, and worship God. When you worship him, you're not worshiping him for land, you're not worshiping him for water, you're worshiping him for who he is. My God, God is looking for a worshiper, one who loves him, not for stuff, but one who loves him just because of who he is. I don't know about you this morning, but if your worship hasn't increased, hasn't deepened since COVID-19, something is wrong. Every morning you wake up, every day you can lift your hand, every day you can open your mouth, every day you can move about. Worship, 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 worship. Worship, worship should rise up on the inside. A worship. Oh my God, I've come to a place where I realize and discover sometimes I've been the one to delay my own blessing. I've been the one who have prolonged my own pain. But when you learn the power of worship, notice the Bible says, and Caleb, without hesitation, calls the surveyor, finds
The closest spring. My God, I am amazed every time I read the word of God. He didn't give her one little well, and I would have been happy with some well. But the Bible says he gave her the upper springs and the lower springs. My God, I wish somebody could understand that what God has for you is not a little cistern. It's not a little well. It's not a little catchment. It is a spring that never runs dry. The upper spring and the lower spring. God, here's what happened, folks. Is that I've come to realize that God pours the spiritual spring. But not at the cost of the natural spring. Now, we worry about a lot of stuff. That's why we're no further than where we are. You talk to an investor, and an investor has a different mindset than a consumer. All you got to do to capture the imagination of a consumer is the S word. They just see S. So what some merchants have done, they raise the price a couple weeks before the sale. And then when they put up the sale, they said 20% off. And you have no idea you're still paying their cost just because of the S. An investor has a different mindset. An investor doesn't have difficulty releasing to receive. An investor knows that before they can receive, they have to release. See, most of us are so afraid of lack that we can't release. So when COVID-19 hit, most folks, as a matter of fact, even before COVID-19, it was said that the average American family is 3 paychecks away from bankruptcy, which means it doesn't matter how most people earn, if their income stopped 3 months from today, their mortgage would foreclose, they would come and repossess their cars, and they would even come and repossess this, that, and the other, because regardless of our high earning power, we still don't have a reserve. A reserve. A reserve. An investor knows that just as much as I save or spend with wisdom, I've got to pay myself forward. And how do I pay myself forward? I've got to put money away that I don't see. That goes off in investment. Regardless, I'm not telling you where to invest. I'm just saying, if you are not investing, you are consuming everything. A farmer, back in Bible days, a farmer knows that if he was to grow corn, he doesn't eat all the corn. He got to take some of the corn to replant. The idea is if your life is bent on consuming everything, all you need is one little crisis. So what COVID-19 has done, it has forced us to think differently. I mean, they actually suggest that you should have at least 6 months' salary available, that if your job stopped tomorrow, you at least have 6 months. You don't have to panic about being on the street. But the point I want for us to understand is that most Christians never make the transition from an investor to a consumer. Always consuming, always enjoying the blessing, and miss out on what they call compound interest. The idea is, my friend, if you ever discover what God has placed in your hands, and if you could ever lift the blinders from your eyes and stop settling for poverty, it will shift the generations to come. The problem today is that most of, we say, the builders' generation, those who have invested in, that their children don't know how to manage money. So most folks, even if they have wealth sitting, if they die tomorrow, the next generation will be homeless in probably a year. The point is, I want us to see that we are heirs of a godly inheritance. Amen. Oh my God. Here's what happens. F. E. Marsh, he listed a few, and it kind of blessed my heart. He says, God has given us an acceptance that can never be questioned. In Ephesians, give me 2 minutes. In Ephesians chapter 1 and 6. The idea is that when a believer understands who we are in Christ, we live a different lifestyle. We function with a different perspective. Here's what happened, folks. Notice what happens with Aksa when she went to her father and she says, Pops, I need a blessing. And he goes, how can I bless you? She didn't go, I'm not sure. She knew specifically what she needed. Do you know what you need today? Do you realize how many times Jesus healed folks? And he asked them, what do you need? Because many times the obvious is not the conscious. So here's what happens. So F. B. Marsh goes, he says in Ephesians chapter 1 and 6, to the praise of his glorious grace, which he has freely given us in the one he loved. God has given us grace. There's grace over your life. But notice, he has given us an inheritance that can never be lost. 1 Peter 1, 3 to 5, praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he has given us a new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, into an inheritance that can never perish. He has given us deliverance that can never be excelled, a grace that is unlimited. He said, my grace is sufficient for you. He has given us a hope that can never be disappointed. That means if God closed the door this morning, he has a bigger hallway opening up for you. Don't worry about what God allows it to stop you. There is something greater on the other side. He gives us a bounty that can never be withdrawn. He gives us a joy that need never be diminished. In other words, even when life is treating you in a bad way, you can still have the joy of the Lord. He gives us a nearness to God that can never be reversed, and a peace that can never be disturbed. He gives us a righteousness that can never be tarnished. You say, preacher, how is that possible? Because he clothes us in the righteousness of Christ. In my own righteousness, it is like filter rags. In my own holiness, it is marred, because the flesh can only produce what the flesh can produce. But when you are in Christ, you are clothed in the righteousness of Christ. So that's why we can say, I am what he says I am. If he says you're holy, you are holy. If he says you're righteous, you are righteous. If he says you are rich, even if you're in bankruptcy, you are still rich. If he says I have you covered, he has you covered. He says I never leave you nor forsake you. I will be with you until the very end. And even when the doctors give you a bad report, he says I am still Jehovah Rapha. I show up in the moments of crisis. And whatever you're facing this morning, Jesus Christ died and left an inheritance. It's amazing, because an inheritance doesn't go into effect until the person dies. So in other words, when I take my last breath, the card, the stuff, whatever I left for you, you can't come claim it while I'm still alive. But when the breath leaves my body, you can show up and say, Pop says, this car belongs to me. That belongs to me. Well, I'm here to tell you, when Jesus Christ breathed his last and says, it is finished, man's redemption is paid, he signed the will and testament. He says, as a child of God, you are now entitled to the full package, not the half package. You're entitled to the full package of God's inheritance. I want us to stand this morning. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. When we sing, God is my all in all, that's why that song was resonating so much in my spirit. Because it's one thing to sing it, it's another thing to believe it. When Aksa stepped from that donkey and positioned herself to make a request on her father, she had absolutely no doubt what his answer would be. What would it be like if we came to Jesus with the same confidence? Here is a need. Here's a situation I'm facing. And I am approaching your throne of mercy and grace in full confidence that not only will you hear, but that you will answer. Here's what happened. So when you came this morning, probably the devil is telling you to throw in the towel. Probably the devil has been telling you, you know what happens? God doesn't hear. God doesn't care. Why don't you just give up? But you are here for a purpose. And if there's anything I want you to know, your inheritance is still available. Those two boys were living in a cave, had no contact with their grandmother. But by law, when she died, her descendants were entitled. In other words, what God has for you, no one can take. Nobody can steal your blessing. Nobody can bypass and take what God has for you. Now, I know we're still working with some COVID restrictions, but I feel in my spirit that if there are some things which are being held up and God is speaking to your heart, and especially if you've been vaccinated and you feel like taking a walk down to this altar, I want to invite you. I believe that God wants to release blessings on your behalf. Here's what happens, folks. When God dropped that word in my spirit, a worshiper has a shortcut to God's heart. It is a consciousness that when you get to that place where, in spite of what you're facing, you said, God, I'm still yours. I told you about the traits of Caleb, that in this time and age, that's what we need to practice. We need to practice that courageous consistency that says, God, I'm your man. Use me where and whichever way you feel and desire. For my one heart's desire is to do your will. I want us to pray. But if God is speaking to your heart and you just want to take a walk to the altar, I don't know where you are. But one thing I do know, God has been speaking to my heart. Too many of us have settled for what God has in store. You see what happens, folks, if we had the time, we could tell you about the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. The idea is that the Spirit is literally like a spring which continues to refresh. And we've come to an age where our Christian lives have become so convenient. My God, I know sometimes we talk about the excesses of the past, but we have gone to the other extreme. Nobody wants to do anything that inconveniences them. And I'm here to tell you, until you get serious about what God has for you, you will settle for less than what God has for you. But this morning, upon the authority of the word of the Lord, I've come to remind somebody that God has not only land, but God has upper springs. He has lower springs. He has everything you need to refresh and to supply the needs of your heart. Let's go before the Lord in prayer. Father God, we bow before you today, grateful for your mercies, grateful, Lord, for who you are and for the call you have placed upon our lives. This morning, even as we gather in your house and as we gather on the E-Church, on the E-Campus, God, I pray, as you search the hearts of your children, show us, Lord, where we have stepped out of alignment with your will. Show us, Lord, where we have turned to disobedience. Show us, Lord, where our Christian walk has become one of convenience. Show us, Lord, where we have allowed the enemy to rob us of our godly inheritance. Show us, Lord Jesus, where we are, and give us grace to step back in line with you. Forgive us, Lord, of our sins. Forgive us, Lord, of our disobedience. We surrender our lives to you, and I pray that you'll give us grace, like Caleb, to exercise a new quest to inherit everything that God has for us. Father, some of us may have earthly springs, but we need an outpouring of the heavenly spring. Some of us may have things, the possession, the comfort of life, but there's more to life than just what we have. Give us a hunger, Lord, for your spirit. Give us a hunger for the baptism in the Holy Ghost. Give us a hunger to become so immersed in your presence that we literally lose sight of what's happening around us. Help us, I pray, to discern the urgent call to give ourselves to something much greater than convenience and to inherit everything that you have in store for us. I'm going to pray for those who want to give their hearts to the Lord this morning. Maybe you once walked with the Lord and now you no longer, but wherever you are, I want the church to help me as we pray. You may be in the building, you may be on the e-campus, and God is speaking to your heart to rededicate your life to him. Pray this prayer after we want to encourage your Father. We bow our hearts before you today, grateful for the godly inheritance which you have made available unto us. Forgive me of my sins, O Lord, and give me the grace to pursue everything you have in store. Let me not settle for less. Let me not walk away from what you have established for me. And give me grace like Caleb, that I will mentor a generation to come that will pursue divine blessing. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Come on, give God a praise offering. Give God a praise. I want to encourage us today.